Gig Gab, the Working Musicians Podcast, episode 171. Nope, I have that backwards. Episode 171 for Tuesday, June 26th, 2018. Folks, and welcome back to Gig Gab, the podcast by, for, and about working musicians. Sponsors for this episode include Simple Contacts, where we'll tell you how to get $30 off your first order from this pretty cool service. But here in Durham, New Hampshire, I'm Dave Hamilton.
Here in Los Gatos, California, Paul Kent.
Oh, you got loud there for a second, Paul Kent, but I can fix that.
I'm boisterous today.
You are. How you doing, other than being boisterous?
I'm doing good, man. We hit the ground running. You know, I'm doing 4 or 5 gigs a week now, and I'm loving it. And it's cool. You got a lot of stuff going on. Before we get going, I did want to compliment you that, you know, your pinball wizard is a pretty damn good pinball wizard, brother.
It's a song I would never have picked to sing. It was one that was handed to me by Russ and Fling, but it was handed to me after after we knew each other for a while, and he was right that it fits my voice perfectly. So it's fun.
You know, I think of that and one of the first songs you and I ever played together, that you would come out from behind the drum set, that U2 song, I Will Follow. And these songs seem to get you to emote in a very natural way. And it's really, really fun for me to watch you because, you know, most of my perception of you is what you're doing behind a kit. When you come out front, it's always so fun for me to see that side of your performance chops because those two in particular, like you never sing anything poorly. That's not my point. My point is more, these songs seem to get your mojo going and it's really fun for me to watch.
That's good. Yeah. Occasionally I will cross the backline meridian and come to the front of the stage.
Thou shalt not pass.
That's right. Yes. You know, it's funny you mentioned U2. I went and saw them on Friday night, and I hadn't seen U2 in 20 years, maybe more than 20 years. The last time I saw them was down in San Antonio. Lisa and I went and saw them, and I don't know if they were good or bad, to be perfectly honest with you, because the sound was just horrible, you know.
But isn't this, of all the many techno wizardry shows, isn't this one like almost over the top, the amount of technology that's layered into this, the staging and lights and all that stuff?
So that's the thing, right? Like U2 has always been a band that uses technology, you know, and evolves along with tech, right? But so 20 years ago, I saw him and the sound was bad. And both Lisa and I walked out of there and were like, OK, well, we don't need to go see this band again. You know, that's fine. And then, you know, the past couple of years, you know, we've heard some friends going to tours and stuff. I'm like, you know, are we missing something here? Should we? OK, let's try it again. So we bought tickets and we went. And for anybody that hasn't seen videos or pictures of how U2 is doing what U2 is doing this tour, The stage layout is, on the surface, it looks like, you know, main stage at the end, big long catwalk that runs the entire length of the arena, or the entire length of the floor of the arena, I should say. And then what looks to be a little sort of satellite stage at the kind of the back of the floor. What actually happens is that many things, that catwalk exists, but they have built a dual-sided video screen that is the entire length of the catwalk. And it moves up and down and can either be all the way down or all the way, you know, kind of all the way up or anywhere in the middle. And things can be inside it. I don't want to ruin anything for anybody that's going to see the show. But you know, things and even people can be inside this thing. And it in and of itself is a technological marvel. Like, I still haven't gone and researched what exactly it's made of, because it can display, you know, what you or I would call HD video, right? But when it's black, it's a almost see-through mesh. And you can see the other side of the arena through it. It's really, I don't know, it's pretty amazing. So yes, that thing is totally over the top. But other than that, Mrs. Lincoln, the tech for the show appeared to be very minimal. And it's sort of hard to say that when there's this huge, big, it's not an elephant, but it's a big screen in the room. But really, the entire show was focused on these four guys playing rock songs on stage. And the cool part was that there was no main stage. They used both stages at either end of the floor pretty much equally. And then they used the catwalk a lot. And there was, and they had a set of drums that they would put on the little stage, you know, at the other end of the floor where they did, they think about their rock show like a lot of people think about theater shows. It's not a theater show. It's a rock show, but they are very intentional about the vibe that they create and all that stuff. I mean, it's who they are. But there was one moment where Larry was on a drum kit on what I'll call the main stage. Bono was singing from the alternate stage, and then Edge and Adam Clayton were on opposite sides of the floor. So the four of them were surrounding the floor, but again, the light, other than this crazy screen, the light show was really quite minimal. I mean, they were well lit. You could see them and you could hear them really well. But it wasn't like there were lasers or anything like that. There was just this crazy screen. But even the screen wasn't distracting from the fact that there was a rock band playing rock songs. And Bono's voice was the best I've ever heard it, as good as it's ever been, perhaps even better. And what really blew me away was the Edge's voice. I had no idea how well that guy could sing. The harmonies he was doing with Bono were great. You know, everything was, it was just spectacular.
So think about deconstruct a couple of those things. So
sure. Yeah.
Think about playing music, even with the best in-ear mix you could possibly have,
yep,
and having your bandmates be a couple of hundred yards away from you.
Yes. Oh yeah. Yeah. Well,
where did they rehearse that?
That's interesting. You wonder if they rehearsed it in one room, but all facing away from each other.
Right.
Right. And I actually have a related story to that, but let's stick with the U2 thing and we'll circle back to that. But you know, yeah, it was pretty interesting. And the sound, I mean, I know why other bands don't do this, because it's remarkably difficult to do, but they had no speakers like on the end stage facing the room. Every speaker was in the middle of the arena facing out. And what was really cool, and it took me a while, it was a very nuanced thing, but it definitely was happening. The soundboard and the light board were actually up in the loge sections. There was no mixing happening from the floor. But what was interesting is no matter where any given player was, a little bit more of their sound came from that location than from everywhere else. I mean, you could, even if Bono was, you know, far away or whatever, you'd still hear the vocals, you'd still hear the guitar. But, you know, if the Edge was house right, more of his sound seemed to come from house right than anywhere else. It was really quite interesting. And my guess is that the entire room was, and the speaker system was tuned so that no matter where you were sitting, you got
stage correct spacing.
Yeah. The spatial correct. Yeah, exactly.
So, amazing, I mean, really exercise in sound design, right?
Oh my God. Yeah, exactly. So
you kind of expect that from you too.
You do.
The other point I was going to make is, you know, remember when stadium shows started? Like, I know out here in the 70s, we had these Days on the Green. Bill Graham would produce these, you know, the biggest bands, and you'd get four or five of them on a bill, and you'd be outside in the sun all day. And then, you know, it was about how bands' arena shows would translate to stadiums. And I remember when Bruce, you know, did the Born in the USA tour, it was a whole question about this intimate experience that he would have even in an arena size, how would it translate to 60,000 people? And, you know, that was an interesting exercise.
Question. Yeah, there, right.
Right. But now it seems like, and I can only imagine the overhead. I know Taylor Swift came through town not too long ago, and she had this huge, amazing set. You know, it's got to be hundreds of thousands of dollars per show.
Oh, for sure.
To transport, set up, operate, tear down. I mean, it's so the overhead. But I guess that's the thing, is when you're charging, you know, $200-$300 in a place where you're going to share the experience with 60,000 people, what's going to justify that $200-$300 ticket? What did you pay for you too?
I think we were in what I would call, like, in a normal arena show, we were in lower loge seats, directly across from the main stage, which turned out to be great because, you know, they were right in front of us for, you know, half the show.
Cool.
Yeah, which is great. And I think we paid, I think it was about $300 for both seats. You know, I mean, I bought them from Ticketmaster. I didn't buy them, you know, from StubHub or anything. But yeah, face value was $150, $160 a ticket, I think. So, which is terrible for me to sit here and say, you know, it's not that bad. Because for a really long time, concerts were like, you know, $24 or $12 or even $8.50, right? But, you know, this times change. I was telling my kids, I said, you know, when I was, because like my kids, and I'm sure your kids sort of dealt with the same thing. Like, my kids can't do what I did where, you know, every summer I was going to, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 concerts and I was paying for my tickets, you know, they were $12.50. And I joked with my kids. I said, well, you know, it's like I used to look at a concert ticket as worth like 3 hours of work, right? You know, I worked for like $4, $5, $6 an hour and it was like, okay, 3 hours of work, I can go to a concert. The problem is it's still that way. It's just that my hourly rate's gone up and so has the tickets on the shows. So, you know, I don't know. Actually, U2 was cheap in that regard because some shows
are which is surprising because they used to push the boundaries of expensive, right?
They did, yeah. You know, and at least... I'm going to sound like a jerk, but Lisa and I are, we go to a lot of concerts, right? And so when we go to see a band that will attract the folks that only go to say one concert a year or something, right? Or maybe one concert every 3 years, we always sort of walk into the venue like, all right, well, we got to deal with the amateurs, right? And U2 certainly is that way, right? I mean, I have a lot of friends that are like, oh, yeah, U2's touring. I'm going to go to a concert. It's like, okay, cool. Like, that's great. You know, it's great. But it kind of sucks when you're dealing with, you know, people that aren't quite sure of the flow of things for bathroom lines and that sort of thing. So you just deal.
Kind of sound like a jerk, Dave.
Yeah. No, I definitely sound like a jerk. I know this. But here's the thing. Like, I've a lot of times you wind up with people that drink way too much. And then they're just belligerent. And that's the thing that I really worry about with the sort of, you know, quote unquote, amateur concert crowd.
Yep.
And there were certainly people that had more to drink on. And this was a Friday night show, but, you know, more to drink than they normally would or whatever. But U2, and I mean, it comes from Bono as their frontman. He really sort of throughout he has the cadence of a preacher, right? You know, for sure.
For sure.
And his overall message throughout the show, I mean, sometimes explicitly, sometimes implicitly, is we all need to get along. Like, you know, he talked about, you know, people on the left and the right need to get along. Men and women need to get along, all this stuff. And what it really did was it translated to everybody in the crowd. I mean, this couple next to us, these two were fighting and this guy was a class A jackass, right? I mean, we heard him before the show and we're like, oh, no. But anytime this guy had to cross in front of us because we were between him and the, you know, the aisle. And so you have to get up or, you know, you move out of the way. Everybody stood for the show. Thank goodness. But, you know, we had to get out of the way, which is fine. It's how it works. Every time he was like, oh, thank you so much. Pardon me. Excuse me. Like he was the most polite guy in the world. I was like, oh, look at that. And everybody was that way. So like the band definitely, you know, their message kept that place safe. And there were way too many people on the floor. Like the floor was unsafely packed from our vantage point. But it never, from what we could tell, it never turned into a problem. So, which was good. You know, it was we were like I said, all around pleasantly surprised by the experience.
I always think that those things are an exercise in the odds because they'll pack them and nobody knows what the magic number is or, you know, what the magic amount of booze is and whether those two dots are connected. But all it takes is one very bad thing to happen. And then the whole house of cards kind of falls in. Right.
It's totally true. Right. Yeah. And it definitely was packed to that capacity where if things went sideways, it was going to go really sideways. You know,
I wonder if they're watching alcohol sales. And whether there is like a barometer of like, oop, these people are drinking a lot, you know, like we got to watch this pretty
better
carefully.
Ratchet it back or whatever. Yeah. I bet.
Interesting.
Yeah. I'm sure.
Well, cool.
I'm
sure well,
yeah. So
good stories, man.
Yeah. So you asked about rehearsing and how you two would rehearse for this. And I said, without seeing each other, that has been my experience. We started Tommy rehearsals. And when I took this gig, I asked specifically, I said, hey, you know, is the band going to be able to see like the stage? And the answer was yes. What I didn't think to ask, because that is true, I can see the stage and so I can see the people that I'm supporting.
The letter of the law versus the spirit of the law, right?
What I didn't think to ask was, will the band members be able to see one another? And as it turns out, the answer is no. The keyboard player, who is the music director, and I are on the ground floor. And then the rest of the band, four pieces, two guitars, bass, and drums. I think two guitars. We've had a problem with guitar players. They've been disappearing like Spinal Tap drummers. we laugh, but... the four of them, so two guitars, bass, and then a horn player, are above us, literally standing on a platform underneath which we are set up. So, and the keyboard player and I were supposed to be able to see each other, but they couldn't fit. They built the stage in such a way that he can't fit where he was intended to fit. So he's actually behind me. So I'm literally playing this show blind in terms of my fellow musicians. I can hear them in my ears, but that's it. And it's really kind of weird and not entirely the most fun way to do something like this. But, you know, I joked, but it's not really a joke. I feel like I'm in a closet solving math problems on the drums. And, you know, and then we get to the break and we all talk about the math problems we just solved together, you know. But it is fun music to play because it's Tommy. So I have a lot of work to do. Yeah. It's fun. I'm splitting the show with another drummer, which has been great during rehearsals because he's been there. And so we get along really well. And so there's this sort of friendly competition between us. It's like, you know, I'll play an act and then he goes to play another act. And he's like, oh, man, I don't know if I can do it. You know, like and it'll be like, man, I hope you make as many mistakes as I did, because that wasn't great. You know, it's very unnerving knowing that you have another drummer watching you and reading the same score that you're supposed to be playing, because invariably, you know, you'd be like, oh, I can't, I'm going to like fake this groove or whatever. And you're like, I know George knows that I'm faking the groove. He's the only one in the room that knows, but I know he knows. But, yeah. So it's interesting. I don't know. It's interesting.
So I got a couple of cool questions that have come in, you know, hey, very,
can I talk about our sponsor before we do those cool questions?
Man. All right, please, man. Please do.
Cool. Our first sponsor for this episode, as I mentioned at the beginning, is Simple Contacts, where at simplecontacts.com/giggab, you save $30 on your first order of contact lenses from these folks, right? And contact lenses are really important. You know, you got to wear them so you can see on stage, assuming that your fellow musicians are within your view, as normally would happen, not necessarily like what's happening to me this week. But here's the thing about Simple Contacts. You get to save the time and the big expense of a trip to the doctor, and you also get to save on the contacts themselves. Not to mention the $30 that we can save you with either simplecontacts.com/giggab or coupon code giggab. And the reason is you use your phone or your computer to take a vision test to confirm that your contact prescription is working for you. So you put your contacts in, you take this vision test. It costs $20. It's reviewed by, a doctor, right? $20 is way better than the $200 that you're going to spend at the eye doctor. And this test, it takes you like 10 minutes. So you don't have to like schedule an appointment and leave work or whatever. You know, you just do it at home. And then you can order contacts. And the prices, I did this with my wife. The prices are so much lower than what she was paying for the exact same lenses. It's really cool stuff. So you got to check it out. Go to simplecontacts.com/giggab, GIGGAB, and or enter coupon code GIGGAB at checkout to save your $30. Now, it's important that I tell you, the eye exam you do through them is not a replacement for your periodic full eye health exam, but it is enough to renew your prescription or confirm your prescription and get things rolling here is really what's happening. So check it out. SimpleContacts.com/giggab. Our thanks to Simple Contacts for sponsoring this
episode. Thanks, Simple Contacts.
Yeah. Yep.
Good technology, good site, good service, good product. And tell them Paul and Dave sent you and you save some money.
There you go.
All right. Here's an interesting question. We got it from Rob on Facebook. and our Facebook page, and our Facebook community is getting, you know, a lot of really good love coming on. Someone, Jonas, just posted a really nice note saying that he's enjoying the show and it helped him get ready for his first gig, which was really nice. We're here to help everybody.
So cool.
But this question, yeah, that was a really, was nice to hear. And, you know, note to everybody listening, we'd love to hear from you guys. We would do this if no one was listening, but knowing that, you know, someone out there in different parts of the world is listening, empathizing, has some thoughts, we want to hear from everybody. So we'll give you the info to get in touch with us at the end of the show. But for now, one of the questions that came in, here it is. Being on two different coasts, it's interesting the similarities and differences you and Dave encounter with gigs and bookings. Do either of you guys notice the influx of musicians, baby boomers, or maybe retirees or soon to be that are used to, that used to once upon a time play in a garage band, or once in a blue moon, they used to get out and play with some friends and now want to get out there in full force since they're about to retire and their professional career is over? Do you notice it? And does it affect your gigs, your bookings at all? I like this because this is in the heart of the world that I live in, right? And I would say, heck yeah, you know, you see this all the time. And, you know, my first thought is, as long as they're trying to hold the value for the rest of the musical community, that's cool. You know, go do what you can. You can make the arguments about, you know, have you earned your place and have you paid your dues and all those types of things. But, you know, that's in kind of anything. If, you know, someone has a connection, they go to the front of the line, that's life.
Yeah. So that's totally how it goes. Yep.
That is how it goes. And again, you know, it is a concern unique in the music industry that the qualitative ability to evaluate good versus mediocre is all over the place. And so that's what's hard is that, I would assume, again, Dave, I always bounce this to you because, you know, you lived around Austin and you saw what the music scene in Austin was, where I would think that the gene pool there and the competition there just makes the water, you know, rise for the good guys. And it's, you know, a different scene for the amateurs. I would assume Nashville's similar. New York would probably be similar. But yeah, I noticed that there is a constant influx of people who want to get back into it. I have my own thoughts about, you know, the process of cutting in line and taking a good date at a good bar or a good club, you know, despite not having paid your dues and, you know, done the things that other bands have done to work their way up, and then not being that good when you get that gig, and that it makes the overall scene a little bit watered down. But I think, you know, the most important thing to me is the, you know, those guys who are in the semi-retired state, I'll do it for free. I find that pretty heinous.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and to add insult to injury here, oftentimes the people in charge of selecting and hiring and booking bands don't necessarily value the quality of the music as the most important factor. I don't want to necessarily say that they don't even know what good quality music, what the difference is between, you know, bad and good music. But that's also true some of the time. But even people that do know the difference, a lot of times that's just not the most important thing to them. It's how many people are you going to draw and how much do they drink, right? If it's a bar. So, you know, they're the whole system of playing in bars is non-optimal if you approach it from I'm going to be the best musician I can be and put the best band together. It's like, well, that's good, but then you have to, that's not enough. You have to go further than that. And sometimes you'll get somebody like Rob describes that, you know, perhaps spent a career in marketing. And even though, you know, he or she wasn't, you know, spending all the time playing their bass, they're good enough on bass to go and fake it and understands marketing well enough, better than you perhaps, and is going to go and get those gigs, and their band is going to be popular despite the fact that you sit there and they're like, how does that band get those gigs? We're way better than them. It's like, well,
let me extract on that. So sure. One is, this is not only a club and bar scenario or totally. Phenomenon. You know, this definitely extends to a lot of private events where there Absolutely. Is money to be made. Yeah. And, you know, it's like, hey, my brother has a band and, you know, boom, 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 and it's done. So, you know, That is unfortunate. You know, even with the guys who were good marketers, And that's a really interesting angle that you bring this up, is like, someone has the chops to understand that this is a business equation, not just a creative equation. That, right, that definitely needs to be held up. However, my experience is those guys are usually good for one or two gigs, rarely more than that. Mm. And so again, you know, the band will get the third and fourth gig and then peter out and tank out, because you can only ask your wife to come so many times. And so the bands, even with ex-marketing executives or professionals who are in the band that really invest the time and expertise to develop a following. And then, you know, the following is an interesting thing, because like, I know a band that plays in this area, the wife gets on, they only play, you know, 3-4 times a year. The wives get on Facebook, they get everyone, their school kids, friends, and yep, 3 or 4 times a year, they're pretty successful.
Right.
Right. Right. But I've also seen the fifth time a year, it'd be not like dramatically different, right? It'd be like, you know, once it's an inconvenient time and the kids are busy and, you know, or we just saw them 3 months ago or whatever it might be, that there is a drop off. And so that's the thing is, you know, as musicians, I think we need to constantly educate our clients, you know, whoever they may be, about how professionally we run our enterprise, our organizations, you know.
That's interesting.
How vibrant is your social media, right? And whatever social media you want, Twitter, Instagram, sure, Facebook, whatever it is, how vibrant is it? How much are you investing in this?
And don't forget your email list on that list.
Yeah, absolutely. That's social media too.
It's perhaps the most effective social media for marketing a band specifically, I think.
But, I agree.
Yep.
I agree.
So there you go.
Everything else gets to be noise to some degree.
Exactly. Yeah. Email's noise too. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. But yeah.
So, you know, more people playing music, good. It's unfortunately not like it was in the 70s, where many places were open 7 days a week and they had, you know, the up and coming bands could, you know, test their metal on Mondays and Tuesdays. And then the headlining bands played the weekend gigs. That doesn't exist as much.
The drinking age is raised, right? I mean, yeah. I think that's a big factor in that.
And yeah. Smoking is gone.
Although bars in areas that every area where, you know, I mean, it's most places now, but as each area has gone from smoking to non-smoking, there's a 2-week dip almost consistently across the board, 2-week dip in attendance. And then it's right back to where it was before.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
My point being mostly is that there's very few 7-day-a-week live music venues in most towns. Austin, I would imagine there probably still are. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's certainly busier Thursday through Saturday, but yeah. Yeah, you can find live music.
But the new bands,
yes,
most venues know, all right, cut your teeth here. Let's see what you're about. And are evaluating, hopefully, the whole holistic opportunity. Not yep. only can they play, but, you know, what do they look like? Can they perform? Do they bring in anybody? You know, does it work on all cylinders? So that's kind of my thoughts about this. It's like, yes, there's always, you know, influx of people. And it seems, you know, that classic rock still is as popular as ever. And, you know, a lot of people get kind of set in their career or towards the twilight of their career, and they want to go back and do what they love, which I think is a great thing. I just, you know, would encourage, you know, understand you're wading into an area where there's no bar to entry. And if you're going to do that, you wade in and, you know, tip your hat to the people who, you know, do it to put food on their table. And at the very least, you know, understand what the wage scale is. And, you know, if you're going to be that guy who you're going to compete on price and you're going to give stuff away just to satisfy your yayas, there's kind of a connected implication to this, you know. And the other side of it is, if musical communities are strong, you know, I think the rising tide lifts all boats, and, you know, everybody can be better off for it. You agree with that?
I totally do. Yeah. Yeah, for sure. I like this concept of intentionally communicating your professionalism, right? I mean, that's sort of what we're talking about here, is making sure they know. And like you said, holistically, professional when you're playing, but also professional when you're not playing, when you're promoting yourself, when you're conducting yourself, right? That whole thing. And this goes back to the, you know, you used to drop off a demo packet and promo flyers and all that. That's changed a little bit now, but it's still the same kind of thing. You know, you can throw somebody you know, 5 links to 5 different YouTube clips or Facebook clips that people took of your band, or you can take those clips and assemble them together, blend them a little bit, put a little, you know, a banner on the front of them where it's like, hey, here's the House Rockers, here's Fling or whatever, segue the songs into each other. And even though it's just videos from people's phones, it looks way better than just watching videos from people's phones. Communicates professionalism. It's the same thing. You just put a little time and care into it. Yeah,
absolutely. It has been a lesson for me. Half the guys in my band are full-time musicians. They pretty much teach in one form or another, either going out to people's houses or people come to them, or they have a studio somewhere. One guy, one of my horns, manages a marching band program. So he's hired by the parents, you know, to get this marching band, you know, competitive. And, you know, it has been such a life lesson to me to watch these guys. They work damn hard. $100 a night gig is actually a meaningful thing to them, because five nights a week, that is $500. 4 weeks a month is $2,000. 12 months of the year is $24,000 of their income.
Yep.
It is, you know, it is part of what they do, and they work their butt off for that $100. And if you don't even want to think about what it comes out to an hour, and the way that you talk to, you know, when you have a conversation with someone who is a full-time musician, they take themselves very seriously. They still practice, you know, they wake up and they still, you know, run the rudiments and, you know, run scales, and they, you know, they still do things that are essential. They keep their chops up. They're ready to take advantage of all opportunities. They are very serious that this is my gig. This is what I do for a living. And it's not, it's very different from the guy who's like, hey, hire my band. We're awesome. You know, we just got together and we're sounding great, which maybe they are. But what I'm saying is that, like in any profession, being a professional is a thing, you know, and it deserves respect because it's damn hard work. I mean, it is, it is a commitment. It is a sacrifice. I mean, more than anything, it's a sacrifice. And to all these guys' credit, I don't know anybody who is a full-time musician that regrets it. Most of them, like the guys who I talk to in my group, they just say, it was never a choice for me. This is what I'm here to do.
Yeah.
And, you know, that amount of passion, commitment, sacrifice deserves a lot of respect. And so we should all respect that. No matter what level you're coming into the game, you should all respect, you know, what true professionalism in any craft.
Yeah, I agree with that. But you need to understand and expect that you will be competing against people that don't care.
Oh, they do.
That.
Yeah, absolutely. Right?
You know what I mean?
Absolutely. Like, they understand, like, it's part of the game.
It's just part of the game.
Shake their head.
Yep.
They shake their head and they say it's just kind of ridiculous, but it's not going to make them lower their bar. And that's where, you know, a lot of my respect comes from. Is
absolutely.
They're like, nope, you know, like the horn guys, you know, they'll look at like Miles Davis and the sacrifice that Miles Davis made to become Miles Davis. And that's the model that they have for excellence in their craft. Right. Now, again, there's a lot of side stories around that analogy and comparison.
Of course.
But my point really is, it's not like they didn't put their instrument down for 20 years and make that sacrifice. And whatever they're playing right now, they've earned, you know, through a lot of mechanisms, you know, chops, contacts, you know, performing, you know, whatever it may be, they've earned those gigs. And it is a real thing. So, like I said, yes, people come at all different levels and you come in. The guys who come in after not having touched their instrument for 20 years and say, hey, I'm going to get this going, and I got contacts, we'll be on stage in a month, and they're on with a bunch of other, you know, part-timers. Be good, but, you know, don't dilute the pool, right? Don't cheapen the experience of the music consumer, of the talent buyer, of the, you know, the entertainment goer. You know, be cognizant that that's what's at stake here. Be, you know, hold your head up and, you know, be a part of that solution, not create new problems.
Like I said, I'm totally with you. I just, like, there is a group of people that don't listen to shows like this, right? Don't care about that message. And we have to know that we're going to be going up against them. So there's the things you do so you can sleep at night. And that's what we're talking about here, right?
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Right?
We had a discussion months ago where I called someone out who I knew anonymously on the show. He was not happy with me. He came back to me and he was like, well, listen, I play for fun and I'm entitled to play for fun. And, you know, if I take a gig for no money, that I'm not in it for the money. And, you know, that was his point. He was fully grounded in that. But you know what? I can just share my position the same as he can share his position.
And totally.
If what I'm saying resonates with anybody else that's listening to this,
that's a good thing.
You know, this is the conversation, right? Again, you're not going to get in a fist fight over this, hopefully.
I
mean, but you know, if you want to understand how an opinion is formed, this is the logic that I'm offering behind it. And you know, it seems like you're mostly along with me for the large part. Is again,
oh, I'm definitely
you
with
know,
you.
All you can do is talk to people and explain to people, you know, why you feel a certain way. And, you know, hopefully it's a civil discourse and you know, that's what it's about. And, you know, like I said, I told the guy, you know, you take a gig for nothing and you're undercutting with everybody. Why should someone pay the next person?
Right.
He said, not my problem. And I said, that's everybody's problem.
It is everybody's problem. That's correct. But, you know, I guess maybe this is just me being jaded and having dealt with it enough. Like, that's how the world works, right? So I try not to spend a lot of energy working to convince people that I don't think are ever going to change their thinking to that way. And I just do, I follow my own advice or my own preferences on this, right? Which is, you know, exactly what you're saying here, because it lets me sleep at night. It's like, yep, I went out, I put on a good show. I didn't undercharge. I know the next band that's coming in is going to be able to, you know, pay their bills. And they're not going to hire me because I'm cheaper than that. You know what I mean? Whatever it is, I do it for me. I mean, I do it for the common good, but I also know that there's somebody out there that doesn't even factor that in. I don't want to say they don't care about it, but that's probably another accurate way of saying it.
Yeah, there's definitely people listening to the show who are like, screw these guys. Yep. You know, I sleep fine at night.
Shaking
you know,
their fists.
I'm out, you know. Yeah, I mean, and that's part of the world. But the music industry is an interesting one in that the bars to entry are different than, you know, you wouldn't do that with a plumber or an electrician or an automobile or, you know, anything like that. But music is this very subjective thing. And, you know, the idea that you have to self-sell.
I think you would do that with a plumber. I think people hire based on advertising and perceived professionalism as opposed to actual talent, right?
I want the best plumber I have because I know it'll be really expensive if I don't get the best plumber.
Exactly. Same. And oftentimes the best plumber is not the most expensive guy. I mean, I get what you're saying. Like if you have the wrong one, then that's when it gets expensive, right? But
yeah.
But yeah. Oh, I'm with you. But, you know, like if you don't know which plumber to hire, you know, and you're just going on, well, who advertised and who did this? It's like, yeah, OK, fine. I'll just go with the name that I know, even though there's no good reason to trust them. So but I don't know.
Yeah, and again, I just want to temper this a little bit. It isn't about being confrontational in every financial negotiation. It's always just trying to get the best deal that can be had.
Yeah.
You know, I think that skill is what the noble pursuit is when you're a musician, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's like, you know, can you do a little bit more is the starter level for those conversations. Or, you know, and then more advanced is, hey, we've been doing pretty good here. You know, it seems like the bar is pretty full. Are, you know, we're going to keep pushing this. Are you open to negotiating a part of the bar take? You know, might be the intermediate level of this discussion, right? So, again, it's a willingness to fight the good fight that says music has value. Me as a musician has invested a lot to get to the point where I'm worthy of being on your stage and entertaining your customers. There's value there. You know, let's talk value for value. That's kind of where my head is.
Yep. I'm with you. I'm totally with you. It's an interesting thing. And it's frustrating, right? I mean, I can hear the frustration when you're kind of laying this down here. Well, 'cause you have to deal with it. I guess the way, so you and I deal with this a little bit differently, right? You're the one that books your band. And so you're on the front lines of this. And as I've said many times, I have mad respect for you and everyone who does that job because I've done that job. And a long time ago, I decided, I'd really rather somebody else do that job, you know, because of this, right? It's this disastrous kind of process that is, you know, it's just a mess. And you're selling what the worst part is at times you're put in a position where you're forced to sell something different than what you know you're actually going to deliver. Not that you're going to short sell somebody, but you're highlighting, how many people and how much beer you're going to sell when what you really care about is putting on a freaking great rock show with your band, right? And it kind of sucks that you have to, you know, stand in both of those, you know, arenas at the same time. But you do. That's how this is done. And that's frustrating.
And that's actually why I find that that fall off happens, because I know for me, I know it's necessary for me to do what I do, but I really, as long as I've been playing music, I wanted music to be the opposite of my day job life. I didn't want to have to, but you know,
but
I realized it had to be done. And you know, that's a big part of it. And that's actually why those retired, semi-retired marketing executives, that's why you find the fall off, is because the reason they don't want to do the marketing anymore is often, you know, they've kind of gotten to their sunset on that. So, you know, it is not fun to do this. It's way more fun to practice your guitar than it is to build a mail list. And, you know, so that's why, you know, even that influx of day job professionals that have come into the music world in every community all the time, it, you know, it doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to be any better. I mean, I've known guys who, again, once the light bulb goes on, that this is their path to, you know, feed themselves and get buy insurance and pay their rent and all that type of stuff. You see guys, you know, licking envelopes and putting up posters and doing whatever it takes. That hunger drives a lot of success. You don't always get that hunger. I mean, it's not impossible, but you don't always get that hunger from the guy who's just recently, you know, stepped out of a day job, especially if that was a day job with a lot of pressure and a lot of, you know, a lot of demands. You don't want to step right back into that, right?
Well, at least so maybe not.
The playing field is more even than we would think.
That's true. There are natural obstacles. Equalizers. I like that. Yes, that's right. Because you've got to be... You've got to be willing to really do it and commit. And that's so, the demise of most bands right there is when you get sick and tired of the grind. Of course, that's the demise of most businesses too. I mean, it doesn't matter. Rock band, whatever. It doesn't matter. Like that's, you got to, you know, hard work. It's always hard work. It doesn't mean that you need to work 22 hours a day, but you have to work hard when you're working. And that's just how it is. Otherwise that shines through eventually. Like you said, you get the first couple, three gigs and then, oh, this band's kind of lazy. All right. Why am I working this hard?
I'm not taking any extra for this.
Exactly.
Or the amount I'm taking extra for this isn't near the amount of hours I'm putting into this. There's a lot that goes into that. So, I mean, I don't, if any part of what Rob asked in the question was, should he be discouraged that these, you know, semi-professionals are coming in with resources or, you know, an untapped fan base of wives and girlfriends that haven't seen them play. You know, I still think the hardest worker wins at the end of the day, not the best musician, the hardest worker.
Yes, I agree with you. I agree. That's just how it is. But, you know,
it's just life.
It's just life. Yes, that's it. All right. Well, I got to go to a Tommy rehearsal, man, because it's time, it's time to go in the closet and solve math problems.
Awesome.
Fun stuff.
Cool, man.
All right.
Good chat.
This was a good chat. Thanks so much for listening, everybody. Rob, thank you for your question. Thanks, everybody, for all your comments and questions. As Paul said, we were going to tell you how to do that. Feedback@giggabpodcast.com is the way you get in touch with us. Or you can join our Facebook group at it's easier this way. Go to giggabpodcast.com/Facebook. That'll redirect you to the group and that'll get you there. So we're very happy to be able to do this every week. Thank you, folks. Thanks to our sponsor, Simple Contacts.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul.
Good talking, Dave.
Good talking.
Hey, man, I got a tip for you.
Yeah, man.
Always be performing.
Even when I'm in the closet solving math problems. There you go.
Good one.
All right. Take it easy, folks. We'll see you next week.